What I really want to leave you guys with, the first thing is the new water paradigm. Why that's something that's important, how it can benefit you directly and your children. The second thing is the old water paradigm, how that put us into the situation that we're in, climate change, extreme climate, drought, fire, and flood. And then the third piece is water and how it's Earth's blood. And if you want to understand nature and water, just draw that analogy between yourself, your own body, and the Earth as its own living body, and you can really begin to understand a lot of things. And so if you look around and look at nature, you can see it all over in the creeks, in the rivers. This same architecture mirrors our own veins and the circulation of our own blood. And it's not just the water moving through the land, but it's actually the water moving through the air as well. And the trees are moving and controlling and respiring this moisture. So this is the water cycle. The sun heats up water off of the oceans, and that water vapor, in order to turn into clouds and rain, it has to have a condensation nuclei to form around. One of the main ones is hygroscopic microorganisms produced in the underside of tree leaves, and around these microorganisms, the water vapor condenses into liquid, forming clouds and then rain. As that phase change happens, the water vapor goes from really big to really small and creates a vacuum effect. The same kind of thing is happening as trees respire. They're cooling a huge amount of area and they're bringing moisture back into the atmosphere. So they're actually an elemental part of this. As the moisture drops, it creates more low pressure, drawing in more moisture from the coast, and that water is hitting cool, shaded ground and infiltrating into it. This is feeding springs, rivers, creeks, keeping that water clear, cool, and healthy throughout the year. It's recharging the water table, and this is a living, breathing cycle called the biotic pump, where the trees and the ecosystems on land are actually creating the moisture cycles and this conveyor belt moving moisture from the oceans inland. So this is how Earth's biotic systems work, how the living systems of this living planet, we call it planet Earth, you could really call it planet water because most of the surface is water. And this is just such a key component. Now, what do we do to that? Well, we come through, we cut all the forests, we clear all the land, we drain the wetlands because that's where all the good soils are. We make a bunch of bare ground for farming. We build cities, we build piping networks to drain all that water away. And this slowly degrades the water cycle. On the hot, dry soil, like a dry sponge, it can't absorb any of the water. So the water, when it hits, just flows right off, leading to flooding and erosion downstream, but leaving drought. All of that water goes to all of the riverways and waterways, and so we think they're clogged up. We dredge them deeper, but that actually lowers the water table in that whole ecosystem when you dredge those rivers deeper. So as all that hot air is hitting, the sun's just heating all of that up and is creating these high pressure domes that actually, as that maritime humidity tries to enter, it's pushing back on it and the pressure just builds. Eventually the pressure is so much it overwhelms these heat domes and creates these huge cloudburst flooding events. And so this is a cycle of drought and flood. When the rain comes, its power is too much, it erodes the dry, dead landscape, causing flooding and erosion, but all the while the water table is actually sinking deeper and deeper, even though there is flooding. Now, the rivers are starting to go dry, the springs are starting to go dry, the fish don't have enough oxygen. The ecosystems are really beginning to collapse because there's not this foundational element. Now, humans, we just drill wells into the deeper parts to get that water for irrigation. But we're just increasing the rate and intensity of desertification, making something that's going to take millions of years to repair. Then the droughts come, the crops fail, eventually the fires burn up the whole landscape, and you're left with desert where it was rich, fertile, verdant ground. And so this is this cycle of extremes, extreme flood, extreme drought, extreme fire. We're seeing it everywhere in the world, from Australia to here. Anywhere you are, you can experience these extremes. And so let's take a little history lesson and look at what's happened in different places. This is a tree, it's called Big Mama. It was alive on this continent, Turtle Island, before Christopher Columbus arrived. And through its lifetime, it has gone from a system of stewardship where people understood and recognized the interconnectivity and the sacredness of all life to one based on extraction. And we've gone from being able to drink out of any river, any stream, any lake, to entire watersheds being not serviceable for fishing or swimming. And that's one thing for us, but the fish can't go to a doctor when it's sick. When its water is toxic, it has to live with our toxicity. So let's look at some of these old river basins. This is the Levant. 10,000 years ago, this was one of the most fertile places in the world. This was the birthplace of agriculture. It didn't used to look like this, but what happened is as they broke up the landscape, as they poorly managed grazing animals, they killed all of the vegetation that drew in the moisture from the coast, and so now this is a hot, humid desert because there's no condensation nuclei. All of the biological systems that would make that humid hazes actually fall as rain have been taken out of the equation, and then that conveyor belt has stopped, and so now you get the desert that it is. And we've done this to the tune of 1/3 of the whole surface area of the Earth in 10,000 years. That's what humans have degraded in really a pretty short order. And what really scares me is we're getting better at it. We're doing it better, bigger, faster. So we have these cities that are all just draining all of the water away and nothing to offset that. And not only that, but usually these cities are down in the bottom of a valley. So this is Bogota. You can see all of the water actually feeds to this valley that would have been full of wetlands and would have helped infiltrate that water into the water table. Now it's all just being drained away, causing flooding downstream, followed by drought. And so you see the effects of it in these natural disasters that there's really nothing natural about, with huge scale flooding all around the world, huge scale drought all around the world, huge scale fire all around the world. And these things, this water scarcity, is actually leading to famine, it's leading to refugee crisis, it's leading to war, it's leading to all these different human quality of life issues. So this is a graph that's water flow over time, and it's showing you what the concreted landscape does to water flow over time versus what the rich vegetated landscape can do. So this is the same amount of water, but how long it sticks in the system. So in the concrete landscape, that rain comes, it all runs off. You know, everything above here is runoff, and then none of that infiltrated into the ground, so very quickly, the whole scenario is dry. Your photosynthetic growing season is incredibly short here. Also, the time that trees are cooling the air, 590 calories per gram that they respire, that's greatly diminished. In this living system, you still have some runoff, but a lot of that water is actually absorbed into this cool sponge that's just ready to take it. And so that water flow through the system is extended. Now, what do you end up with in this designed flood and drought scenario? Well, you end up with erosion, you end up with risk, you end up with the costs associated with those. Then you have to have insurance for flood and crop failure and drought and fire. Then you have the finance charge to do all of that. But because you're designing for the flood, you're also designing for the drought. And so then you also need crop insurance for that side, fire. And this is really creating a situation that's just, it's not viable. It's not viable for farmers, it's not viable for stewards of the land, for homesteaders, for anybody. And so this is what that picture looks like. This is New York City under Indigenous stewardship and under colonial stewardship. Now, in the Indigenous stewardship, there's an understanding that all life is interconnected, that it's all sacred, and that it's all important, and this is what that kind of stewardship results in. In the colonial perspective, everything is a resource with energy to exploit. It's going somewhere else. It needs to be turned into money. And it really speaks for itself, the difference in these landscapes. So we have situations where we know we've lost, but we also have situations where we're actively losing. So this is the Amazon, and a really good example of the biotic pump. So in the Amazon, between 50 and 80% of the moisture that falls is created by these hygroscopic nuclei, created by trees. So if you clear more than 50% of the Amazon at once, you're actually creating a bunch of high pressure domes and this conveyor belt that brings moisture in through to the rest of the continent. You start breaking that up, you start building the pressure on this ocean, creating more catastrophic hurricanes in different areas, but you're also reducing the amount of precipitation they receive down here because of deforestation here. And so it's the level of interconnectivity, it's everywhere. It's between nations, it's between continents. And so what do we need? We need a new water paradigm. We need a new way to look at how we manage water. And so a lot of this comes from my mentor, Sepp Holzer, and it's really the most important thing is to love and respect nature, to love and respect water, to treat it as a sacred good, as a common good, and a shared resource for all life. And when you start to partner with nature, you can create some really incredible differences. So here's a community that didn't have enough water. That's that community after creating a water retention landscape. This is just with the rain from the sky, and now they've gone from being on a deep borehole well to having shallow springs and drinking water that's recharged by their own water retention landscape. He's created this beautiful farm, the Kramaterhof, which is really an amazing example. And it's left me with people talk about environmental footprint and trying to keep their environmental footprint small. I want to have a really big environmental footprint because our footprint can be bad or it can be good. And if we're just focused on having a less bad footprint, we're never going to have a good footprint. So you'll see we're using equipment, we're using diesel, we're using excavators, we're using the resources that are available to us today to set the landscape up for future generations as best as we can. And when we do it naturally, we're installing systems that will last for generations, for till the next ice age if they're really done properly. So another great example of the new water paradigm, another mentor, Rajendra Sindh, who started in India and started creating these retention bodies all by hand and created this movement where they've brought water back to 250,000 wells now have water that were dry before. In fact, impacting a million people, regenerating seven rivers all by creating these decentralized water retention landscapes that hold the water in the natural veins of the earth, recharging that and rehydrating other vein lines because of that retention feature. So this community was out of water. They drilled 27 boreholes, wells, what we call, all dry. And then for the same cost as those, all of that drilling, they built this huge, I think it's like a 20-acre reservoir. This community went from 9 hectares of agriculture, was all they had water for, to 650 hectares. Their increase in agricultural productivity paid for the cost of this 4 times over the first year, and they will always have this water to draw upon. So the very first year, it more than paid for itself, and it's gonna pay for itself for generations, really, through their children. And it really becomes a quality of life thing, because in India, if you don't have water, the females go get it, then the female children go get it. And so they end up not getting any education because they have to haul water all day to make sure that the boy kids can go to school and have the resources they need. So when you start to repair the water landscape, it has impacts on war, on refugee, on gender issues. It causes this whole cascade of effects. And so some other pieces of the new water paradigm. One thing I think is really important is we need to recognize and stand together against the privatization of water. The privatization of water, in my opinion, is criminal. It should be prosecuted as criminal. And if it goes through, it's gonna really make things hard for a lot of people. For example, in Australia, where they've fully privatized the water, there was a situation this year where fish were flopping around dead in the river because they took all the water out. Indigenous communities haven't had water for 3 years now, and they're wasting water, the people who own it, to artificially inflate the prices so that they can make more money off of it. And so it really, it's a common good. as is the land. And we really need urgent legislation that allows people to steward their landscape and to steward their water. Because until people are allowed to do this, we're not going to be able to repair our own landscapes if the government keeps telling us what we can and can't do. They really, like Rajendra, this amazing project where they've impacted 1 million people, he had something like 70 legal cases against him by the government because they were impounding water. They don't want that water in the landscape. They want it going to their large dams and reservoirs that they can then sell it or monetize it for electricity. So this privatization of water and ability to cultivate our own landscape is something that we need to just have the civil courage to say, this is what we're going to do. We as the people, and this is what they did in India. They banded together and they actually ended up coming out on top. So what this new water paradigm is about is really fundamentally changing our relationship with water and recognizing that it's sacred, that it's for all of us, it's for all life, that we need to hold it in the ground. Once we start to hold it in the ground, the vegetation is going to come back. Once the vegetation comes back, it's going to be respiring that water, it's going to be cooling the atmosphere. If we can terrace and revegetate the hillsides that aren't being used as much, we can put more water into the ground for other areas. And as soon as we start, we're working with a force that has endless momentum when you're working with nature. Partnering with that, we're starting this perpetual motion machine that can always serve the best interests of ourselves, of our communities, of our children, and of the human race, but also the living world on this planet.